Okay, thank you, Arji, for the introduction. I'm Dimitris Mavridis. I'm now based in Greece, and along with my colleague Anna Haimani, who is now in France, will give a presentation on how to handle missing outcome data in aggregate data meta-analysis. I hope you can see my screen now, and there are not any problems. So just to give you some details about this webinar, I will present the theoretical part, and then Anna will present the practical in Stata. Anna will have all her slides in the PowerPoint file so that you can follow the file, or if you wish, you can open Stata and follow the commands. You have a do file, and you can follow the commands in Stata. Before I start, we would like to acknowledge the contribution of some colleagues of ours, especially George Salandi and White and Julian Higgins, with whom we had many discussions on this topic, and we have received much help and guidance. And of course, they are not responsible for any mistake we may make. So just to give you some details about this webinar, it's about missing outcome data. And in meta-analysis terminology, missing data may refer to different things, such as missing studies. This is the problem of publication bias, missing outcomes, or more often missing statistics, where you have some studies that do not report the standard deviation or some other statistic. So it's not about that. We consider studies in which some of the participants dropped out from the study. And we don't have individual participant data, so we only have aggregate data. That means that we have only effect estimates of individual studies reported in the published literature. And we know that in some of these studies, some participants did not provide any outcome data. And we will present a relatively new method to deal with missing data in aggregate data meta-analysis. And I say relatively new because this method, such similar methods were suggested almost a decade ago by Ian White and Julian Higgins for dichotomous outcomes. Now we have extended the method to continuous outcomes and also to network meta-analysis, where you have more than two treatments compared. So, as I said, we focus on aggregate data meta-analysis. Had we have individual participant data, we could have employed various methods to account for missing data, like multiple imputation, other likelihood methods. But we do not consider this case here. And typically, systematic reviewers assume that the missing data problem has been solved at the trial level and proceed with a meta-analysis on available data. And whenever you make an assumption about the missing data, actually you make whenever you have a meta-analysis or any statistical model with missing data, you make some assumptions about the missing data that you cannot actually test from the data itself, because the data that you need are missing. So we are going to see how to deal in such cases where we have missing data, and the most popular approach is to an available case analysis, where actually what we assume is that the observed participants is a random sample of all the participants randomized to that study. So we are going to use two examples from the area of mental health, where missing data is usually a big problem. One example is about trials comparing haloperidol to placebo in schizophrenia. The outcome is dichotomous. It's the reduction in symptoms in some standardized scale, but we have dichotomized it. And the other one is eight trials comparing mirtazapine to placebo for the reduction of symptoms in depression. We're going to give a very brief overview of currently used methods. And we will present a method that is based on what we call an informative missingness parameter that relates the missing outcome to observed outcomes. So why missing data is a problem? Because even in very well randomized clinical trials, you expect to have missing data. And actually, in mental health, the dropout rate may exceed 50%. So that would create two problems at the at the random at the RCT level, we lose power and precision because we design our trial so that, and we determine the sample size so that it achieves pre-specified levels of statistical power, but we lose participants, also the sample size decreases and we don't have the power that we were planning to have. And also it may cause bias if the missing data differ from the observed ones. So actually, as I said, we have to make some assumptions about the missing data, and the validity of the results will depend on the plausibility of these assumptions. And if we make wrong assumptions, then we are likely to get biased estimates. So we do not consider that there is any remedy for missing data. What we can do is actually sensitivity analysis. We make assumptions about the missing data and we see how robust the results are to these assumptions. So before getting into details about the suggested methodology, we would like to present you with a fictional example. Suppose that you have five studies, all of which have 100 participants, data from 100 participants. You have the SMDs in the third column. And let's suppose that the standard error is the same for all five studies. So each study has the same weight. So the meta-analysis estimate is actually the arithmetic average of the SMDs. That should be equal to 0.2. Now suppose that I give you some extra information, which is the number of participants randomized to that study. So in the first trial, you had 100 participants randomized and you got the data for all of them. In the second trial, you have 120 participants randomized, you have data for 100 of them, so you missed 20 participants. And in the last trial, you had 300 people randomized, you have data for 100 of them, so you missed 200 participants. This is 67% of the randomized participants. So the question would be, would you give each study the same weight in the meta-analysis? And actually now we will give that as a poll. So I give you four alternative answers. Yes, we'll give the same weight because each study has the same number of participants, data from the same number of participants. No, I'll give study five the largest weight because it has the largest number of randomized participants. No, I'll give study one the largest weight because I don't have any missing data. No, I'll give the smallest weight to study one because the standardized mean difference is zero. So I would like to give you half a minute to think about that. How would you treat this data? Do you think you can answer in the poll that you can see in the webinar? And so from what I see, 56% answered C. I will give the largest weight to study one. And then 33% gave answer yes, A, yes, because I will give the same weight because all studies have data for 100 participants. I would go for C as well, so I agree with the vote. But in practice, this actually what we see in most meta-analysis is A. People just do an available case analysis and they analyze only the observed data. But I wouldn't trust so much the estimate for study five because I lost almost 67% of my data. And I would like somehow to incorporate that into my model. So I believe I should give the largest weight to study one, but I need to find a mathematical way to assign weights. I cannot just say that this study will get 50% of the weight or any other value. I need to find a mathematical way to determine the weights of the studies. So now we'll get back to this example later on. Now, to obtain valid inferences from missing data, we must consider the nature of the missing data mechanism. And there is a very popular taxonomy for missing data developed by Little and Rubin, which is the missing completely at random, missing at random, missing not at random. And all these categories actually relate the probability that data are missing to either observed or unobserved data. So if we believe that the probability that data are missing does not depend on observed or unobserved data, this is the missing completely at random. And you can think of an example, let's say of an RCT on antihypertensives. We measure the blood pressure, and at some point the machine breaks down, so we don't have the measurement. So this is completely random. It's the missing completely at random case. Then you have the missing at random, where you believe that the probability that data are missing does not depend on the outcome or other than observed data, but it depends on observed data. And I have a similar example from the same trial. Let's say that for some reason, older participants are more likely to have their blood pressure recorded. And this would be missing at random, because at any age, individuals with low and high blood pressure are equally likely to have their blood pressure recorded. So once we condition on age, missingness is the result of a chance mechanism that does not depend on the outcome, on the actual values of the blood pressure. And that's a mistake. This is missing not at random, the last one. Sorry about that. So it's missing not at random, MNAR, where we assume that the probability that data are missing depends on the outcome. And I have an example of a randomized clinical trial of antipsychotics, where people do not see improvement and they drop out from the trial. This is very common. The reason they dropped out is because they didn't get any better. So the reason they dropped out is the actual value of the outcome, the value that I want to measure. This is the missing not at random case. So we're going to use two examples. One for a dichotomous outcome, haloperidol versus placebo in schizophrenia. We have 17 trials. And another one for the continuous outcome, mirtazapine versus placebo in depression. We have 8 trials. And also, I would like to give you, I will take one study from the haloperidol example, the dichotomous outcome. I have haloperidol versus placebo, 29 successes in haloperidol, 18 failures, 20 plus successes in placebo, 14 failures. The risk ratio is 1.05, very close to 1. But I also have this extra information that missing rates are 32% for haloperidol and 50% for placebo. So this is an extra information I have, and I wonder what is the data missing mechanism. So that would be another question for you to answer. You have 4 possible choices. Do you think it's missing at random because data are missing for both groups? Most probably missing at random because data are missing for the same reason, but we are not certain. Most probably missing not at random because missing rates differ across groups, and we are clueless about what is the data missing mechanism. So I'll give you half a minute to think about that. Thank you. So we see that 60% of you said that most probably missing not at random because missing rates differ across groups. And I think I would agree with you. And actually, in the Cochrane risk of bias tool, it says that if you have different missing rates across arms, then this means that probably you are at high risk of bias for incomplete outcome data. So since this is a randomized clinical trial, you would expect that the two groups of patients to be similar in everything. So you would expect them to have similar missing rates. This is not the case. So probably the reason that more people leave placebo compared to haloperidol has to do with the actual value of the outcome itself. And we have consulted psychiatrists and mental health scientists, and they say that it's very common in such trials for people at randomized to placebo to leave at higher missing rates because they do not see any improvement. So now we know that most probably it's missing not at random, but how would you analyze this data? And this is another question. There are 4 questions in total. So I would analyze only the completers. I would assume missing participants did not respond to treatment. That means all the missing participants are failures. That means that in haloperidol, instead of 18 failures, I have 18 plus 22, 40 failures. I would assume the same risks in both groups. I'm sorry, as those in the observed, I would exclude the study from the meta-analysis, none of the above. Also, take half a minute to answer this one. Just to tell you that it's not like there is a correct answer for this one. So we are more interested in your views. Okay, so actually 34% replied the second one. You would assume that missing participants did not respond to treatment. So people leave the study because they don't see an improvement in both groups. Then it goes none of the above, and the A is I would analyze only the completers. So what in practice happened in that, because we took that study from a Cochrane review, they analyzed only the completers, so they did A. We believe that the data are missing not at random, so we shouldn't make some assumptions about what happened to the missing participants. So like you said, you would assume the second one, you would assume missing participants did not respond to treatment. So let's see, A, which is what the researchers did, actually assume it's an available case analysis, and the assumption behind it is missing at random. So we assume that missing participants are similar to the observed, and or better, we assume that the observed is a random sample of all participants and we just analyze the observed data. Actually, what you said as the most popular answer is to assume that all failures, all missing participants are failures. So the successes rates would be 29 over 69 for haloperidol, 20 over 68 for placebo. Now the risk ratio is much bigger. It's 1.43, and this is clinically more significant than a risk ratio of 1.05. But what is the assumption behind it? What did we assume? Successes have no chance to drop out, and we imputed the missing participants as failures. There is one problem with this method, is that, okay, you may have biased results if this is not true, but also you make up data. And because you treat these missing participants as if they had been observed, you don't include any uncertainty about the fact that you imputed these participants. These were never observed, and we treat them as data, as real data. So any analysis makes assumptions, which if they are wrong, they produce biased results. So these are the 17 trials of haloperidol versus placebo. You can see three columns per group. R is the successes, F is the failures, and M are the missing participants. And you can see that there is one study here, the Beasley study that you saw before, that has large missing grades. This is the forest plot of these studies. You can see the Beasley study. One peculiar thing about it is that it has the largest missing rate, but also the largest weight. It accounts for 30% almost, and also it has the smallest effect size. These are the data for the mirtazapine versus depression. So you can see that you have the outcome, X, the standard deviation, the sample size, the number of completers, the people that for whom you have outcome data, and the missing participant. And you can see that all trials have a lot of missing data. There is one trial that has a high, large missing rate. And actually, if you see the forest plot, this is the only trial that points to a different direction than the rest of the other seven trials. Actually, it says that placebo is better than mirtazapine. So this is a synopsis of all the methods that are popular for that we found for handling missing outcome data at the meta-analysis level. The most common is the available case analysis. You can do it with both binary and continuous outcome. Actually, you ignore the missing data and you assume that the observed data is a random sample of all participants. Then you have other imputation schemes, like the worst best case scenario. The worst case scenario imputes failures in the treatment group and successes in the control group. The best case scenario is the opposite. This is only for binary data. You have other methods for continuous data, like the mean imputation, where you impute the mean value to all missing participants, or you may assume different imputation schemes. The problem with all these methods is that they inflate the sample size. You make data and you get more spuriously narrower confidence intervals, narrower, smaller standard errors. There is another method that's called developed by Gamble and Hollis. It's only for dichotomous data. They suggest a method of downweighting studies based on how much that effect sizes change when we consider the worst and the best case scenario. The problem with this method is that the worst and best case scenario are usually too unrealistic, and so you get extreme downweighting to studies with a large missing data. So we suggest a new method which downweights studies with high missing rates and relates the outcome in the missing data to the outcome in the observed data.